Let me welcome you all to this seventh in the series of teach-ins. We've had seven series of teach-ins on what the nation really needs to know. That's the name of our teach-in here, which has been going on for the last 8 days with a few interruptions. Today we have with us Professor Achin Vanaik. I remember as a graduate student reading Achin Vanaik's The Painful Transition and being mesmerized by the analysis of contemporary politics that he had offered in that book. He has since written many other things, and he has also been an activist in the anti-nuclear movement. Professor Vanaik today, who has recently retired from the Delhi University Political Science Department, will speak on the power of nationalism.
Thank you very much, Janaki, and thank you very much for mentioning that book, The Painful Transition. My sons have always called it The Painful Reading. I want to start by, in fact, saluting you students and the student community in general for two reasons. From time to time, students become the spark for very, very positive and progressive transformations worldwide. In the 1960s, and 70s. In fact, in the United States of America, for example, the two great mass movements which transformed in a progressive direction the United States of America did not come from the political parties. They came from outside of the political parties, and then the political parties had to accept it. They came from students operating against, in the civil rights movement, against racism. And then you had in the United States, you had in Europe, you had in India, you had everywhere, you had a huge anti-Vietnam war movement that took place. These were real tributes to what students can achieve. In 1968, the spark that the students of France did shook France as never before, so much so that President de Gaulle actually ran away because he might thought he might have to get out of the country. If you look at the 1980s, you find students doing the same thing in South Korea. They helped to overthrow a dictatorial regime. You have, in the 90s, you had the students in Indonesia who helped to overthrow that. In 2000s, after the 2000s, you had, of course, students involved in the uprisings in the Middle East. In North Africa, you had them in the Occupy movement and elsewhere. Students cannot do everything by their own, but they can be a very important spark in helping to unite, and that's why we have to keep on struggling in this country, particularly because, and this is the second reason why I want to salute students, it's very easy and very normal when there is repression against the student community, against this university, to fight against it through the normal methods, demonstrations, morchas, legally, dharna. But you've done something much more, and that's very, very important. You've said that we have to try and fight for the soul of Indian nationalism, because today, let's have no doubts, there is a battle for the soul of Indian nationalism. On one side, there is a systematic attempt to elaborate and to instill a very anti-democratic, intolerant, belligerent, and aggressive nationalism, to which we have to respond with a much more humane, democratic, and inclusive nationalism. This is a battle that is in front of us. And what you've done here is very remarkable, in terms of insisting on having a teach-ins, not just the usual forms of opposition legally and so on, etc., but that we must have this debate about what kind of nationalism we want. This is something from which the political parties outside, parliament, the media, and others can and should learn. This is what we have to do here. Now, in this fight, we have to understand the complexity of this notion of nationalism. Let me start by saying, this is one of the most complex terms here, and we have to understand why there are competing nationalisms and where we have to move. Is nationalism old or new? Modern or old? Is nationalism based on objective characteristics or is it subjective? Is nationalism civic or ethnic or either? Is nationalism universal or particularist or both? Is nationalism inclusive or exclusive or both? Is it doctrine or sentiment or both? It's an extreme. Is it cultural or political or both? Is it good or bad or both? And sometimes If it's good, isn't there some element of bad that's in it? And even when it's very bad, maybe there's sometimes something good in it. It's an extraordinary, complicated, this thing. And yet, we have to move our way towards it. Let me start by saying that, in fact, nationalism is a modern phenomenon. It belongs to modernity. Even if you have an ethnic nationalism, the ethnic community, the ethnic may be old. If it's based on language, the language can be old. If it's based on religion, the religion can be old. But it's a modern phenomenon. It emerges in modern times. Once you understand this, then how do we go about trying to understand nationalism? There have been basically four ways which have been the starting points for trying to understand this modern form of nationalism. First, changes in social structure. That's the starting point for you to try and understand what nationalism is about. What does this mean? The great exponent of this view was a person called Ernest Gellner. He argued, are there any sociology students here? Sociology students, right? Any international relations? I used to teach IR. Any international relations students? Okay. All right. Changes in social structure. What does that mean? He said, in fact, nationalism emerges in relation to the processes of industrialization. Nationalism and what it brings with it is, if you like, functional and necessary for the process of industrialization to take place. But of course, we also know that many countries which do not have serious processes of industrialization do have nationalism. The second approach, changes in political structure. Those who are international relations students would have read and would have been taught or whatever, that 1648 and the Peace of Westphalia is the beginning of the modern nation state. Wrong. It's wrong. Why do they say that? They say because in 1648, you had the emergence of what is called the tax office state, a state which based itself to a great extent on tax collection. You had some agreement on a centralized administration over a rough territory, even if the borders were not complete, a centralized bureaucracy. You had a standing army. You had standing diplomacy. And all these are features of the modern state. So surely this must be the modern state. No. Please remember that in 1648, the states that were involved there were absolutist states. What does that mean? Before 1648, you had feudal states. And all feudal states are characterized by three things. They are decentralized all over the place. They are pastoralized, the king. And they are sacralized. The king has to rule, the divine right of kings. In India, what do we have? Raj Dharma. Right? Ancient texts, we are so wonderful. We have changed. Oh, the king is important. He must be respected, but he must be a good king. Now we do not accept the idea that kings have some divine right to rule. We've changed. So in other words, in feudalism, decentralized, personalized, sacralized. 1648, the absolutist state, centralized, but personalized and sacralized. After 1648, the modern system of nation-state comes through 200 years of also imperialism and colonialism and exploitation. That's why it's very important not to forget this and to fool yourselves into thinking that 1648 is the starting point. And the modern nation-state is centralized, but it is also depersonalized and it is desacralized. The power of the nation-state comes from the fact that it is supposed to belong to the people constituted as different nations, unlike in the past where it's supposed to belong to this royal family or that royal family or whatever. So in that sense, I think it's very important not to take these changes in political structure. The third approach is changes in political consciousness. Right? It's when people become politically conscious and mobilize and act in this thing, that's when nationalism emerges. Not quite. Because you will find that before political nationalism, there is always a certain kind of cultural nationalism, a cultural coming together. That look, in India, for example, it's not the political nationalism or the political movement that comes first. It's some consciousness of us being a culture that must fight. We are different from the British. We have to fight against them and so on. And some sense of cultural unity and so on that emerges. And then it moves into that. It's the fourth approach that I would suggest is the most important, and that is changes in social consciousness. And here, the most outstanding figure and his book, which many of you may have read, Imagine Communities by Ben Anderson. His was very, very important and wonderful. But the best definition of nationalism, if you like, did not come from Ben Anderson. It came from the liberal tradition even before him. But Ben Anderson developed it and made it much more powerful and effective. And that definition, which I want to leave with you, what I want to start with, was given by a person called Hans Kohn in The Idea of Nationalism in 1944. What did he say? He said, nationalism, or the nation, is a cultural entity lodged above all in consciousness, striving to become a political fact. You take nationalism seriously because it has a political thrust. That. It's a cultural entity lodged above all in consciousness. Now this is very, very important, because what it means is that there is only one thing that is common to all nationalisms and all nations throughout the world. And that is the question of consciousness. Let me elaborate a bit on this. Do not make the mistake of thinking that there is some kind of a checklist in which this plus this plus this plus this constitutes nationalism, because you will not find it anywhere. It is not common territory. You will find nations and you will find people who do not have the same common territory who believe that that should be there. Hawaii and the Hawaiians believe that they are part of the United States. The Puerto Ricans, however, have many who do not agree. Right? The Falkland Islands say that they are part of Britain, even though they are closer to Argentina. You had, after 1947 in India, if it was not for the huge mistakes made by Yahya Khan, you had two separate territories, East and West Pakistan, who felt for some time that they are one nation. And in fact, Yahya Khan messed it up because he would not allow Mujibur Rahman and them to become the majority party in their hair. You find all that. It's not common territory. It's not common history. It's not language. It's none of these things. Language? You can have any different kinds of languages you have, and you'll have different people and different countries. The Canadians and the Americans have the same language. Of course, the American presidents and the Canadian presidents are probably more equipped to speak another kind of language rather than English, which is rubbish, but that's a different matter. But my point is that no. Germany, Austria, they speak German, but the Austrians and Germans don't want to come together. Liechtenstein, a small country, very, very small, whose economy is totally dependent on that outside, but for decades has been a separate sovereign state and doesn't want to be absorbed into that, even though the majority language is German. In fact, Liechtenstein is very interesting and quite unique. This small little country, during the Second World War, sent 56 soldiers to fight on the side of the Allies against Hitler. And after the war, yes? And after the war was over, 57 came back. It's true. It's true. It's true. So what's my point here? Once you realize the only thing common is that in one way or the other, from this combination of objective factors, this, that, which differs in parts of the world, people come to think of themselves, the imagined community, as belonging to some kind of nation. And that's the key in a certain sense. So this cultural dimension, I think, is very, very important. And it means in order for us to understand nationalism, we have to understand culture, which is another very complicated term. And there are two ways of going about understanding nationalism. I'm fond of the word two, because I have two sons who have always caused me huge trouble. But anyway, two ways. Either you can think of culture as a thing, or you can think of it as a process. Even when you think of it as a thing, right, which is up to a point, okay, there is also a process within it. This is very, very important. In other words, when we talk about a common culture, you can either talk about a common culture as something that is commonly shared, language, religion, this, that, whatever, or you can also think in a much more important way that it is something that is commonly fashioned. Multiculturalism, the preoccupation with multiculturalism, focuses on the question of common culture, this thing here. There is another tradition, a much stronger tradition, that talks about it being commonly fashioned, commonly created. And the moment you understand it as something that is commonly created and commonly fashioned, then you're talking about the fact that it's not simply that it's commonly shared, common to everybody. There is something called cultural exploitation. There is something called cultural oppression. There is something called cultural empowerment and cultural disempowerment, and we have to try and change it and make it. It's a process. This is something I think very important. Let me elaborate a little bit on this issue. If you understand culture this way, then it means culture is five things. It is plural, the aspect of being shared. It is open. It is ordinary. It is changing. It is expanding. It's plural. We have multiple identities. We are Malayalis, we are Punjabi, I'm a Punjabi. We have, and we have a culture that is connected to that identity. A Malayali culture, this culture, that culture. Even Punjabis, I assure you, have a culture and not just agriculture. I assure you. But we have plural cultures. We have plurality. And not just at the level of language or region or whatever. Even closer, the culture of our school that we go to, the culture where we work, the culture of JNU, all kinds of pluralities that we have. And modern life is not about looking at the world through one prism, which is the most important, religion or whatever. Modern life is about recognizing how we have to shift from identity to identity and use those different prisms to look at different things in different times and different places. So it is plural. It is plural. It is open. It's open to global and influences. If culture has something to do with the way we dress and the way we speak and the way we talk and all the rest, then isn't it obvious? Pizza is not Indian. The dresses and hairstyles of people, both men and women, trousers and shoes are not indigenous to India. Right? We learn, we open, we develop. It's ordinary. What does this mean? There is so much talk about how the wonderful culture of the ancient past, whether it's India or any other country and so on. But let's understand that literacy is a very, very powerful tool for better or worse, for cultural empowerment or cultural oppression. It's a very powerful. In the past, when you only had Brahmins and a small number of people who had the power of literacy, you did not have cultural equality or struggles for greater equality. You live in a world today where the ordinary products of people, a book by Wendy Doniger, a book by Salman Rushdie, can cause an uproar. It's ordinary. It's changing. In the past, you had two kinds of cultures, elite culture, the beautiful monuments and the classical music and all that, and you had folk culture. Then comes popular culture. Popular culture is a bit more spread and wider than folk culture. But it is only in the 20th century, with the emergence of mass communications, that you now have mass culture. And the three most important products of mass culture: spectator sport, which I love, I must admit, dance, music. These are all parts of modern mass culture. When I used to watch Hindi films in the past, the kind of music was totally different from the kind of music you now have with Balli Sagu, and even rap music, I believe, has come into Indian films and all that, right? It's changing. It's changing. It's expanding. Expanding because there are a rights to culture and a culture of rights. And when we have emerged, the period question about modernity is that the great goods of modernity are completely different than from that of the past. And the great evils of modernity are also completely different from that of the past. We have to decide how we are going to pursue this modernity, a critical and modest modernity here. When I said expanding, with the emergence of healthcare, the average lifespan of people has increased. When it has increased for the first time, you then be able to actually divide in the way that you could not do before. You talk about childhood, you talk about adolescence, you talk about adulthood, and fortunately for me, we also now talk about the elderly and about the rights for the elderly. Thank you. But you also have rights for children. If it was not for the extension of the lifespan, and if it was not for the emergence of mass education, we could not talk about the culture of kids, which is that they should be able to have play and leisure and go to school and all that. In other words, culture is all of these things. And why I say this is because you must not have an essentialist conception of culture. An essentialist conception of culture is profoundly dangerous. You will have, and it's connected to the question of nationalism, you will have people who will be saying, you Mr. Hindu in Bangladesh, you Mr. Muslim in India, you Mr. Ahmadiyya in Pakistan, you Mr. Jew in Germany, Margaret Thatcher, our culture is being swamped, you Mr. Asian in Britain, you Mr. Black person in the United States of America, you had better understand that this is the essence of our culture. And if you do not accept this, if you do not help and respect it, if you do not help us to actually strengthen it further, then you are dangerous. We don't like it. You are weakening us. We will not tolerate it. This is a profoundly dangerous conception of culture. And this then gets connected to the question of nationalism. Because you can think again, I apologize, again I'm going to say, you can think of nationalism in two ways. Blame my sons for this anyway. Two ways. Either you can think of nationalism as an inheritance from the past, or you can think of nationalism as something that belongs to the present and the future. If you say it is belongs to the past, Indian nationalism, great here. All nationalisms, as you know, invent a tradition, right? But my point here is that if you really believe that it belongs to the past, and this is an inheritance, then there will always be disputes about what the proper inheritance is and who are the proper inheritors. You, Indian, India, understand that our culture, our essence is Hinduism, and not just Hinduism, but a particular kind of Brahmanical Hinduism, if you like. And you, Mr. Lower Caste, or you, Mr. Muslim, or Christian, or you, Communist, or whatever, you understand it. Right? You will always have disputes about the nature of the inheritance and about who are the proper inheritors. It belongs to the present and the future, and what that means is that nationalism is what we will make of it. And what does that mean? It means in the Indian context and in many other contexts that there must be different ways of being Indian. There must be different ways of being Indian and of feeling Indian. That the person in Manipur and Nagaland, in Kashmir, in Tamil Nadu, in Punjab, of course, elsewhere, must feel Indian, must feel there. But how can they feel Indian if you do not have any respect for their culture, for their language, for their interests? Therefore, you cannot separate the question of building a decent, humane, and nationalism, a democratic nationalism, if you like, from the larger context of building a democratic society. And in a society that is multi-religious, you have to have a secular conception of nationalism, which is not biased in favor of anything else. But even secularism is not enough. Much more important than even secularism is the question of democratic, is that you can have a secular state which is not democratic, but you cannot have a democratic state which is not secular. We have to fight for the kind of India in which everybody of different approaches, different things, can feel. And you can only do that if they feel that the state and that society addresses their concerns, respects them, etc. I am a bitter critic of the United States on many things, foreign policy, etc. But Canada and the United States have one great advantage when it comes to nationalism. Theirs are much more inclusive. There are different ways of being Canadian and different ways of being American. And this is very important. I want to stress this point because just recently there was an industrial trade fair that took place in which President Obama and Prime Minister Justin Trudeau of Canada were there. And in this industrial trade fair over there was a big machine which could predict the future 50 years from now. So Justin Trudeau said to Obama, "Hey, find out what is USA going to be like 50 years from now." So Obama typed into the machine. A big piece of paper came out, Trudeau said, read it. So he read it. America is very prosperous, it's very peaceful, and the President of the United States is Alexandro Sanchez Velasquez. And the Vice President is Chow Ho Fung. And Chinese is now being taught in all US schools. So then Obama turned to Justin Trudeau and said, now you find out about Canada. So he typed in, and a huge piece of paper came out. And then Obama said, read it. He said, how can I? It's in Punjabi. But you get my point. Get my point. Let me say something about the power of nationalism. Nationalism has an extraordinary power. As a form of belonging, nothing matches it. Those of us who have been in the left movement, and we've talked about the international working class, international solidarity, international working class, it has broken on the shoals of nationalism. Those who talk about international sisterhood, it's broken on the shoals of nationalism. Those who talk about Islam, the Islamic Ummah, it breaks on the shoals of nationalism. In Afghanistan, you have any number of Muslims, but different tribes who fight with each other. The second longest war of the 20th century was between Iran and Iraq, in which there were majority Shias, both. And of course, you have all kinds of fights there. It's not been possible. In the case of Buddhism, you may have Burma and you may have Myanmar. They don't want to come together. In the case of Hinduism, for all the talk about an Akhand Bharat, this, that, etc., can you imagine if somebody were to say to the Hindus of Nepal, that you Hindus in Nepal, you are Hindus, forget Nepal and join us. Or you Hindus who are in Jaffna, in Sri Lanka, join us in this collective project here. You know what the response would be? We are Hindus, we are proud of it, but you, Mr. Big Brother India, don't tell us that we have to give it back, right? Why? Why is it that religion is less powerful than, in fact, nationalism? So much so that religious organizations do not try to confront nationalism, but to co-opt it. What's the difference? Why is it? And this is where I think you have to remember what Ben Anderson said when he talked about imagined communities. He did not simply talk about nationalism or the nation as an imagined community. He said it is an imagined political community, which is different from imagined communities like that, for example, of religion or anything else. And what does it mean? It means that nationalism, like religion, is a community of believers. It's a community of believers. These are the two religions for which most people are willing to fight and die for. Communities of fate, communities of destiny. Yes, people will fight for feminist struggles and for socialist struggles and so on, but not at the same scale or depth here. It's a community of believers, but nationalism has one great edge over there. It's not just a community of believers, it's a community of citizens. That is an extraordinary powerful thing, because it means that belongs to you. Even dictatorships, whether in Pakistan or elsewhere, are no longer like those of the past. They don't say that this state belongs to my family. Even a dictatorship will say, I'm doing this for the people of Argentina or for the people of Afghanistan. This is a very powerful, empowering aspect, that you feel that that belongs to you because you are citizens. And even if it's not a democracy, it's still answerable to you in some particular way. However, the structure of religion and nationalism in many ways is quite similar. They both have myths about themselves. They both have their heroes and heroines. They both have their symbols. They have their rituals. All of these things they have. And when they merge together, you can have an extraordinarily powerful impact in terms of a very powerful love, a reinforcement that they both bring to each other. And that reinforcement can be quite dangerous, because the question of a powerful love also sometimes means powerful hates. You have to be very, very careful with regard to how they come together. And religious nationalism is dangerous because, of course, it is not a secular nationalism. By its very nature, it cannot be democratic, because this religious nationalism, however, is different from a communalized nationalism. The difference is that a religious nationalism can take place in Iran, in which everybody is Muslim, or almost everybody is Muslim, right? And a religious nationalism will be opposed to the non-religious or the secular who says this kind of nationalism is bad. But when you have a communalized nationalism, that takes place in a society in which there are many religions, then there will also be not just opposition to the secular or to, if you like, the non-religious nationalist, there will also be a hostility to some religious other. That makes it even more dangerous. And this is something that I think that we have to be very, very conscious about in terms of what's happening. We have to fight it, but that fight cannot be separated from the fight at various levels to make this country a much more humane and decent society in so many ways. You cannot separate the struggle against communalism from other struggles. In order to succeed in the struggle against communalism, we will have to fight against more than communalism. In order for us to succeed in fighting a militarized nationalism, we have to fight against more than militarism, which means the necessity of fighting constantly in that sense. Let me finally come to the good news and the bad news. The good news is that I will be finishing news soon. The bad news is not yet. Okay. There are limits to nationalism. This is very, very important. This business of powerful hates, this business of hostilities, even if it's a good nationalism, an inclusive nationalism, can also be very, very dangerous. It can manipulate you. The idea of my country right or wrong. Incidentally, what is realist thinking in international relations? It's a sophistication of my country right and wrong. But let's leave that aside. My government, state, country, they're all different, right? My country right or wrong usually means my government right or wrong. Soldiers don't like to hear this. And that is that when I went, for example, the NDA, they stopped calling me after that. I said, most of the time, you must understand that soldiers do not die for their country. They die for their government. The two are not the same thing. Sometimes the national popular will is so great, you're fighting an invasion, you're fighting to overthrow this thing, that they do come close together. Even then there'll be small parts that don't. But you have to be very, very careful about this. You cannot say, my country, right or wrong, even if there is mass support, there's a majority support for the Americans dropping nuclear bombs on Hiroshima and Nagasaki, the two single greatest acts of terrorism in human history. That's what they are. You cannot say that I'm a loyal American and I will fight for my soldiers when the soldiers are being sent invading Afghanistan or Iraq. It's true. In other words, the question of morality, of righteousness, has to come in. You can't just excuse anything in the name of nationalism. And you will always find that there are people who are prepared to do that. The United States democracies supported the apartheid regime of South Africa. And you had white people who said, we are Americans, but we are going to align ourselves with black people in South Africa to fight against apartheid, regardless of the fact that the United States government says this is in our national interest. You are not prisoners of any particular identity. We have our plural identities. We also have an international identity. We have the capacity to empathize with international struggles on the basis of justice. We can empathize with the struggle of the Vietnamese. We can be men and we can empathize with the struggle of women. We can be upper caste and we can empathize with the struggle of lower caste. We have those capacities to do that. And it is very, very important that we do that. But I will also say that there are limits to nationalism. Today, let me give you another example of this, very important, because we're talking about this here. There's a lot of talk about the unity and integrity of the country, or the unity and integrity of India. What is meant by this unity and integrity of India? What are you talking about when you say this person, unity and integrity? It's a territory. It's a territory. And when you have a religious nationalism that comes together, right, then you can have a more emotive power to that. So do you know what the Commissioner Basi said recently? He said that those who are invoking opposition to the sedition charge are blasphemous. Not just anti-national, he used the word blasphemous. Why? What has happened? You have sacralized the nation, the unity and integrity of the country. You sacralize it. And what does that mean? And this is something that we have to understand very, very carefully, right? That, in fact, if you are going to be critical of that in any way, you are supposed to be anti-national. And, of course, then you must be punished. And, of course, if you are to be punished, then they will want to change laws and this, that. And that's, in a certain sense, what's happening over there. I want to clarify this point here. I've always been a very staunch supporter of the Palestinian struggle. And incidentally, you don't have to be a Palestinian or a Muslim to support the Palestinian struggle. But if you are in India and you support the Palestinian struggle, 90 times out of 100, you will probably be a leftist or a Muslim. That's a tragedy. That's a tragedy, in a certain sense, of what's happening here today. When I talk about Palestine, and I support Palestine because Israel has been terrible here, I asked students when I talked about it, I said, does, and they are pro-Palestinian, I said, does Israel have the right to exist? And even those who are pro-Palestinian will say, yes, Israel has the right to exist. Then I'll ask them, I said, in that case, if Israel ceases to exist, would that be a great wrong? And they will say, yes. Then I will say, does the Soviet Union exist? Does East Germany exist? Does Czechoslovakia exist? Does Yugoslavia exist? Does East Pakistan exist? No. Is that then a great wrong? What's the point? That sovereignty lies within the people. The central point here is not that Israel and any of these countries have a right to exist. The central point about that is that the people who live there have the right to exist. The people who live in Israel and elsewhere have the right. That's the fundamental point. You can certainly argue, if you wish, that no, in order for them to exist, Israel in this particular territory and extra must exist. But that's a secondary level of argument on which there can be disputes. The point is, it is people. And if it is people that constitute the consciousness, what are you going to do when, for whatever reason, some people say they don't want to be part of it? What are you going to do? You can either move in the direction of Czechoslovakia, Czechia and Slovakia, this thing. You can move in the direction of Canada, have a referendum, this thing. You can move in the direction of Britain, where the Scots and the Welsh have it. I don't know if you're familiar with this, but you have groups, and it's a question that even though the Constitution says it should not break up whatever it is, etc., in the name of constitutional freedom of speech, as long as it's not a question of violence here, you can speak, and they do. So that in Germany, you have groups that talk about Germany verrecken, which means Germany die a miserable death. In the United States, you have groups that say 9/11 is a CIA conspiracy. They are there. You can even burn the flag in the United States. You have Welsh and Scottish nationalists in Britain. In fact, in many ways, this is a testimony to the democratic character and the more open character that you can actually do that. Because make this point is very, very central about the fact that it's people that you have to respect and what they do here. Having said this, what are the... let me give you one more example here. There are leftists and liberals and others in Pakistan universities also. What if a Pakistani stood up in a university in Pakistan and said, Pakistan murdabad, India zindabad, Pakistan ko tootna chahiye? Why? Because Pakistan does not have as strong a democracy as India has. Pakistan oppresses Ahmadiyyas. It has a Hudud ordinance which is oppressive. That in fact there is a Punjabi Pathan connection nexus which is oppressing Baluchis and Sindhis. And you have support of the Pakistan establishment where the Amarmi plays such an undemocratic and authoritarian rule with the Afghan Taliban which is doing terrible things. And if that person stood up and said that, and he is accused, of course, of being anti-national, terrible, this, that, etc., what would many people in India say? They would say, well, you know. And if he was punished, they would say, well, what do you expect? That's an undemocratic country compared to us. But in this democracy that we have here, finally, let me come to the good part. Just three things more I want to say. We are living in a world which, for the first time in human history, is faced by three vital developments which have never existed before and represent a huge threat to human existence on a cross-national, international scale and have to be addressed internationally. For the first time in human history, we have the continuity of mass inequality, mass deprivation, mass suffering, basic needs being unmet, and basic needs today are not just a question of malnutrition, they mean leisure, health, education, freedom from fear, dignity, all of these things. We have it, this people suffering on a mass scale, but for the first time in human history, not because there is a global scarcity of resources. In the past, the problems were much more connected to scarcities, underproduction, development. Today, you have these great evil, in spite of the fact that there is no, on a global level, scarcity of resources. How are we going to address it? One. Second, for the first time in human history, we have the capacity to destroy the metabolic relationship between nature and humans, and for the first time, being able to devastate, in great part or whole, the human species itself. These two things are, in my view, connected to the question of the nature of capitalism. They are connected there. The second business, any of you are economists, you study in School of Economics? Nobody? Well, that's very good. I had to study economics when I was in England. But anyway, and yeah. Conventional economics has substitutability of all factors and no theory of limits. Capitalism can only survive and continue because the strength of capitalism is also its weakness, and that is, of course, the dynamic pursuit of profits, which is very, very energizing in many ways, technological dynamism, this, that, etc., all of these things. But you cannot have a continuous pursuit of profits unless there is a continued pursuit of growth. And this is a huge problem, and in fact, one very famous early ecological economist, whom you can take seriously if you like, because I assure you he was not a Marxist, so you can take him more seriously if you like. A person called Kenneth Boulding, who said, to believe that you can have limitless growth in a finite world, you have to be either a fool or an economist. And he's absolutely right. It's absolutely right. This is a huge danger. How are we going to address it? Do you know what people in India are saying? National security, etc. India is the fourth largest carbon emitter. It will become the second largest, but we have to be concerned about us, etc. Who is thinking about the people who live in the small island nations? Because India and China and others and all these other countries, even as they grow and develop, they're going to get screwed. And for no fault of theirs. And of course, you'll have all sorts of other problems unevenly met because they are rich and poor and they manage the way they manage it, etc. And the third thing, of course, is that we have the capacity through nuclear weapons and nuclear winter to blow up the world. And it is extraordinary that this, of course, is something that is accepted in the name of national security in this thing. There is a profound, fundamental moral issue that is involved here. And that moral issue is that unlike a gun or a tank or whatever, unless you're a complete pacifist, you can use for good purposes. You cannot use nuclear weapons for any good purpose. Even to have them, they are immoral in themselves. Their morality is not determined by the goodness or the badness of the people who have them. And when you threaten to use it, what you're saying, that for our national security, we have the right to be able to threaten the existence of future generations and of the human species itself. What an extraordinary state of affairs. You have two scientists in India. Very different perspectives because scientists were divided. People like Niels Bohr, people like Richard Feynman, people like Einstein were people who were horrified by the question of nuclear weapons. They were horrified by it. In fact, Einstein said, if I knew that my physics would help make it, I would have preferred to be a watchmaker. In India, why go far? In a third way, in a country here, you had Abdul Kalam, the middle class hero, saying how wonderful it is that India has it. But there was another Indian scientist who won a Nobel Prize, not by working in the laboratories of the West, like so many other Indians who have won Nobel Prizes in the sciences. He won it here in India itself, and his name was C.V. Raman. And in 1957, you know what he said? He said, scientists should starve rather than help make nuclear weapons. My point is simply this, is that the struggle to build a democratic and humane nationalism, to build a democratic and humane world, means that we must recognize the kind of nationalism that we have to fight for, and we also have to go beyond that nationalism to actually fight on an international scale for all of these things. We will have to fight it through nationalism for a long time, you know, even to go beyond that. And I think that therefore this question of how we struggle and how we carry on is absolutely central to this wider debate. If this debate on nationalism can continue and can carry on to develop all and understand all of these things, then there may be some hope, because I tell you, throughout history, there have been two kinds of people. There are people who fight for power, and there are people who fight for justice, for dignity, for decency. And they are not parallel paths. They meander. And sometimes they come close together and merge. And when they merge, like in a national movement for liberation against a dictatorship or whatever, it's wonderful, because power is being harnessed towards a fundamentally just and humane purpose. And then when they meander, people will have to choose whether they're going to be on this side or that side. And that's the choice that you and the young generation will have to make. I am now in life's departure lounge. You are in life's arrival lounge.